often dreaming that the religions would come together and would give us again 10 commandments of life. And that the first commandment of all the religions would be, thou shalt not kill, not even in the name of a nation or a religion.
It's time we looked behind the eyes. Faraway lands, faraway places.
And what has to shift is towards a sense of mutual regard for the sovereignty of each nation and a rule of law instead of a rule of force. And that is beginning, and it is a revolutionary shift in the way nation states behave.
Maria, Maria, usi Maria, я не могу нас, не хочу, що ж как що, провалиться я.
Let's try to come up with some practical results. We're here not for just talk. Talk is cheap. Now, let's try to have some practical, concrete results, because we will be judged not by our talks, but by our deeds.
I offer you peace. I offer you friendship.
Stopping the pollution and trying to help stop the overcutting of the forests and the killing of the whales. That's already been done. The Soviets have agreed. You know, let's just generally get our house in order and go help everybody else do it, you know.
Open your heart, America. Open your eyes and see. Turn on your light, America. Your spirit is what you need. And give us your dreams, America. Show us your inner star. Open your heart, America. Your vision is what you are.
Can you imagine a process big enough to allow everybody in our country to join with everybody in the Soviet Union and to create something together? Yes. Our purpose here is to launch a process that can eventually be big enough for the people throughout the whole world, not just the Soviets and the Americans, to join together to create new worlds. Individuals have come from both our nations, and you will be joining together in task forces tomorrow. And in those task forces, we're going to ask each person to speak not only from their hearts, both from their hearts and from their personal passion. What would you like to do? See, the new way of thinking leads to a new way of doing. We have a database of existing Soviet American projects, so that if you come up with an idea, you do not need to reinvent the wheel. You can go find out what already exists and plug into it. We have a team of analysts for you who will help both Soviet and American, who will help you decide which project might be most important. We have an internal media system. The television cameras belong to the people here. They're not outside. And their purpose is to communicate, to pick up your highest moments of creativity. If you're having a great insight, call for a camera and we'll send one in. Because we intend to change the concept of news. From that which is breaking down to that which is breaking through. And there are 300 people who have come across this country to support the participants and the Soviet guests to create this summit. And I told them not one of them is audience. They are all participants. Now, it might overwhelm our Soviet guests, the number of people who want to create with you. You may have to tell the Americans to stop. But I want our Soviet guests to know they are outnumbered 4-1. We could have had twice as many Americans here. We had to stop. And Henry was saying to me at dinner, next year, Moscow. I would just like to say a deep thought of mine is that I don't think it's an accident that at this stage of history, in the nuclear age, that the Soviet Union and the United States of America find themselves on the stage of history as the two superpowers. I think it is because we are the two nations on this earth with the most radical vision of world transformation. And that this vision that has motivated the people in the United States, all men are created equal, and the vision that has motivated people in the Soviet Union, from each according to his ability, to each according to his need. We have come from other sides of the mountain. But as Teilhard de Chardin said, everything that rises converges.
I would like to welcome all of you who have come from every corner of the United States and from many of the institutions and organizations from throughout the Soviet Union. This is so unprecedented according to the Soviets, because never before has there been such a large delegation of over 100 Soviets that have represented such a wide variety of organizations and public opinions and points of view that has ever left the Soviet Union before. I would like to share with you what I have found in taking 800 people to the Soviet Union, what a citizen diplomat is. And perhaps many of you have your own ideas, which it would be marvelous if you could share throughout the week. A citizen diplomat is a world citizen. It is one whose vision transcends the personal, the ideological, and the political boundaries to see the oneness of all of humanity and human unity. A citizen diplomat is one who has the skillful art of holding two points of views simultaneously, discriminating in that the citizen diplomat can see the differences, but not judging in comparing those differences. A citizen diplomat is one also who allows the heart to speak.
Here you are in the Soviet embassy. What are your feelings?
Well, it is such a great party. People, the Americans, were so desirous of coming. We were supposed to have only 60. We have over 100. At the door of the embassy, there were people whose names we didn't have, but they were so desirous of coming, and the Soviet embassy let them in. This television crew, we did not get clearance, and when they saw you at the gate, they let you in.
Right.
And it's like walls are coming down, barriers are coming down. There's a tremendous amount of warmth and friendship.
I feel extremely warm toward the Russians.
Yeah.
It's beautiful to experience that, and you know that that is the way peace will be made between the nations, because we go to your country, and it's the same thing.
What do you think's happening in this room?
A lot of things. I don't know all. I can't say all of it.
You have American dreams. People was the people of pioneers, and now you see only to earth. You may, like, if you are pioneer now,
pioneer.
Not in Proslav.
In the past.
In the past. If you now are pioneer, we must go with us together to the Mars, like pioneer, real pioneers.
Well, you have been in outer space, and most people haven't. The Americans are afraid of the Soviets, and do you think that's one reason why we haven't been planning joint trips to Mars and to explore the universe, because we're afraid? The Americans are afraid. I guess the real question.
Do you afraid me?
No.
You are American?
Yes.
Is that why?
Mr. Henry Borovic
is the president of the Soviet Peace Committee. And please join me in giving him the warmest possible welcome.
I would like to tell you that I have a great honor to give you personal greetings of the General Secretary of the Central Committee of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, Mikhail Gorbachev. He is informed about this conference and he thinks it's very important, and he asked me to tell you that he wishes you every success in our common, noble, and difficult work to promote better understanding between our countries and between our nations. When we were going from the embassy where we had the reception, Rama, Vernon and I, we were together in the car, which was Paul Temple was as they was driving, and in front of us we saw a small car with a sticker on the back window which says "Anticipate miracles." Was it true?
Yeah.
I think that we can call what happened in December, the beginning of December of last year, a kind of miracle. But it was not just a miracle. People worked for this miracle long ago, very much and very hard. And though we understand that only leaders of our countries can sign such a treaty, but we also should understand that we did much, all of us, for that. Not only those who are here in this beautiful hall, but millions of people who marched, who tried to open their hearts, who tried to understand each other by eyes, by shaking hands, by all means of what human being can do to each other. I think that if we speak about pyramid, and on the highest level of it, our two leaders signing this wonderful treaty, the basis of pyramid are people. And Mr. Gorbachev told not once that the people are sometimes and maybe always ahead of politicians. Let's be ahead. Is it possible that we allow some stupid politician or some robot by mistake or by bad will to destroy such a beautiful, long and very hard process of making human human? I think that can we allow the humanity to stop its existence, the civilization to stop this existence? I'm sure we don't. We are not allowed to allow this. If the human being has to die before its natural death, let him die only because of unrequited love. And speaking about miracles, let us not anticipate them. Let's make them.
It's always been.
ask of all a meeting of the hearts. We could use it now. A meeting of the hearts. We really all know how. Сердечный разговор.
And I can tell you that after so many years of trying to understand what it was all about. And when you are in the United Nations, sooner or later you wake up one day and you ask yourself, what is it all about? And then you become a spiritual person. And what is very interesting is that when you ask yourself this question, and you discover that in your life, you are doing what you were meant to do, that all your life is devoted to do good and to help humanity find its peace and way, then I have discovered that the universe or God recompenses us with something tremendous, happiness. I believe that happiness is the price we are being paid for being in right relationships, for being in the right harmony with our planetary form, with each other, with the universe, and with time. We should all be very happy to be alive at this particular time of evolution, when we know so much, and when there is a possibility of making so many revolutions and changes in the way which we behave on this particular planet. I believe the third millennium will be a millennium of peace. It will be a millennium of unprecedented fulfillment. But the basic question will be, how are we now going to relate to this planet and to each other?
And the process includes you going to the task forces of your choice. Now, I want to point out that there are actually three types of participants we have here. We have the Soviet delegation, and that Soviet delegation has been selected and been more or less asked to go to certain task forces. And that has been selected from Moscow. They looked at our list, and the people were selected for those task forces. The second category of participant are the American counterparts of those Soviets. They also have been specifically invited to go to task forces in the area of their expertise. Then, in addition to the participants, there are, as I mentioned last night, the delegates. Now, the delegates have come to support this conference in two ways. One, through their financial support, and more important, through their very presence, they have been invited to select the task forces of their choice. There are also facilitators in every one of the task forces who will assist the chair people in maintaining the process, which you will hear about in just a moment. We invite you to really help us with this design, because if we can jointly create a process that emancipates human creativity, we will start a critical mass, not in the nuclear explosion this time, but a critical mass of creativity that will be a chain reaction that won't stop until it spreads around the world. So when you're in these task forces, you will have chair people, you can tell them what works, you can tell them what doesn't work, and you can be part of inventing the next stage of self-government.
That would set forth for the Americans to know what products the Soviets have to offer, what products the Americans can create for, and vice versa. What products that the Americans would have that the Soviets would be interested in. basically creating an information base similar to one that somebody brought up earlier this morning.
Is to have a high-level conversion conference between U.S. industrialists and their counterparts from the Soviet Union on what conversion from military production to civilian production can mean to both economies. At the last meeting of the U.S.-USSR Trade and Economic Council, Duane Andreas from Archer Daniel Midland, who's head of the U.S. side of the Trade Council, proposed in his opening that each one of our countries could take some $100 billion out of their military budgets to be used for our economies, which both sorely need these funds. And even though it may not sound that it deals directly with trade, it has a tremendous important impact on the question of how we work together on an economic basis and what this can mean to both of our economies.
And then they turned out that they were able to fight these diseases and their problems that they had before.
Да, вот я предлагаю, чтобы объединиться и бороться против болезней и против элементов, которые.
So my suggestion is to unite our efforts and on the way of developing the new way of fighting different diseases like AIDS and to join our efforts on this way. Mm-hmm.
We do know that we will be linked internationally on a computer system as well as on our own educational satellite. We do see that interlinking. Working with Global Village prospects and people within the Phoenix area and the West Coast in Australia. And what we're doing is we're having communications right now about the education that's going to go into the different Global Villages. We're interacting with television, networking, and cable television shows to be able to put educators like the sister here, like all of us here, to get us on cable and get us on television so that when we work with the Olympiads, which I have, and all of those people who are working on the vision of educational change, that we can get it out to the people. And my part of the mission is literally to get it to the parents so that the parents can get it to the children.
Programs to encourage young people to understand what people in the Soviet Union are thinking while they're in high school, because I think you can hardly begin too early to be more realistic in our appraisals of different people. Our cultures are not that different.
One of the things that impressed me when I was in the Soviet Union is that they read so much of our literature. They read all their books, even the ones that are banned or smuggled in, and they read it. But how many of us read any Russian novels except for a very few? Every Russian child studies English, and they know about us.
The main idea is to keep peace in the nuclear free world. How to do that? The Soviet Union proposes, you know, a comprehensive system of international security. It means that that system should rely upon military pillar, political pillar, economic pillar, then humanitarian pillar, ecological pillar. So that's the world should rely upon, and in any pillar there should be Soviet-American cooperation, East-West cooperation. So not on military confrontation, but those five pillars cooperation. So.
And this is why I was so happy today. Frankly, I didn't know what was going to be my project when I sat here. I had two or three things in mind, but when I saw our Soviet brothers and sisters that are here, I thought, well, maybe this is the opportunity because we are like mine, and maybe now.
I know that 600 corporations, United States corporations, they are involved in South Africa, and sometimes people don't want to discuss that. You know. Also, military support goes there. You know that we do not have any trade, we are against apartheid.
So one school is signing the document, another school in the United States of America is signing the same document. It's working this way. But if you go just to the streets with a document and will be asking people, please sign this document, I don't think in this country, I don't know how many of them will sign this document, because there are so many people asking to sign this or that thing in this country. I personally saw it with my own eyes. So I think that it won't be very practical to do this way. To find parallel organizations, school to school, nursery house to nursery house, I don't know Ministry of Defense with the Ministry of Defense on different levels.
That would be even more efficient.
Yeah, this is, I think, the most efficient way.
Some of our members of our group have been working with Soviet counterparts to put together a work camp in Costa Rica, probably in January of next year, and they will be working on a reforestation project. Another project idea is to have a team of Soviets and Americans, about five members of each team, go to a third country, perhaps India, to work on a project for 1 or 2 years together in a health or an environmental area.
И мы, американцы и советские люди, делаем много для развивающегося мира, но если мы будем где-то вместе делать совместные проекты, это будет очень хорошо.
And we, the Soviet Union and the United States, both do a lot of good for the third world, but if we could do something mutually together, that would be very good.
Perhaps a summary of the things we've committed to work together on, like the joint program working on production of films, like the Cossacks in Texas, like the Future Wave film, the musical, the other things that we have now agreed on this board. We've put our names on them, we've signed on them, we've reached agreements to explore cooperative ventures in these areas.
И в этом будет сказываться стремление людей сохранить род человеческий.
Because this would be a sign of the desire of us as the believers to save the humankind.
It's time we looked behind the eyes, far away lands, far away places, used to be oceans separating our shore, but touching the hands and finding the faces somehow, there's just no far away anymore.
What are the primary principles these days of a peace activist? What are the high principles that guide your action?
I think it's a combination of a very deep no and a very deep yes. And the no is to state violence, is to state murder, whether it be terrorism in Nicaragua or invasion in Afghanistan, oppression in Eastern Europe, the first use threats of nuclear weapons, which is the basis of our nuclear policy. We are at the cornerstone of our NATO policy is the threat to initiate nuclear war. So as a peace activist, I put the whole weight of my life in saying no to that kind of wanton violence. Then there is the yes. That yes is to the truth that we are one family, one species on the face of this earth. It is yes to respect and reverence for life. It's yes to the principles of the founding of this country, of the equality of every individual on the face of this earth. It's yes to cooperation. It's yes to shifting our resources away from death and destruction to life and to the enhancement of this planet and the preservation of this planet. So there's a deep yes and a deep no, and it's in the combination of that commitment to life that activism arises.
In the process of working with veterans over the last few years in this country for peace, we have talked about a number of ways that we could elevate the consciousness of our country to be more viscerally involved in peacemaking rather than just intellectually involved. Because those of us who have been in combat and been in war have had to deal with the visceral dimension of insanity. War is insane. It's got to stop.
More than anything else, what I've heard people saying here is we need somebody who. We need to know how to do X. And so today is about connections. And you'll have an opportunity in a little bit to just get up
and wander around and see what our friends and colleagues have come up with and talk with people about the ideas and give your own ideas about how to actually accomplish much of this work.
To build both in Moscow and Washington two identical museums of Soviet-American, Russian-American relations.
I have developed an organization, Defense Executives for Human Success, and I have a company that does electronics for the defense industry. We, sponsored by the Soviet Peace Committee and the Center for Soviet American Dialogue, will take a delegation of defense industry and business people from the United States to Moscow and Leningrad in April.
This is a campaign that's going to happen across the United States, April 6th. I, myself, and about probably 1,000 other people were walking across America for 5 months, getting people to say yes to life rather than no to drugs, no to poverty, no to war.
And I want you to find children that you think might like to be in this so that they can participate in the youth summits, which are going to report the Youth Ambassador Summit and the Direct Connection Summit are going to be reporting directly to Gorbachev and Reagan after they happen. And this is a chance for kids to be able to say what their ideas are and their hopes for the world are on a whole range of topics and know that they're going to be heard.
Our idea is to create a management institute that would offer management exchange programs between Soviets and American management teams, to create trainings, workshops, and seminars, to publish books and articles, to create perhaps a traveling rail show that would visit a lot of Soviet cities, where we can have one railroad car that would be full of the latest computer technology, another railroad car full of trainings and seminars and exhibits, etc.
Вторая программа предусматривает повышение ответственности.
Another project presupposes raising the moral and ethical responsibility of journalists. Physicians are known to have the pledge of Hippocrates. We would like to join our efforts and draw up a creed that every media person should subscribe to. According to that creed, a journalist cannot speak for war, for violence, for conflicts among nations.
Convergence Center is a place where everything seems to converge.
Not people, only just people.
People and papers and computers and, well, you can see it all around you. It is a place of convergence, of everything coming together in the mind and in the heart. And so in here we are mapping all of the projects that are coming out of the task forces. We have a research base of information that is available to the people here to make their projects very real. And we have a lot of computer equipment here to try to capture all of the information that is coming out of the task forces so that we can give it back to everybody who's here.
We're in the process of doing our final edition of the daily summit, which is the Summit Daily, which is the daily newspaper to provide good news to the participants here at the summit.
And that comes out every day. When do they receive it?
They receive it at the plenary session each morning. It's on their tables, and we have one for each of the participants, and we have also translated several key articles in Cyrillic, in Russian, to have available for the Russians.
I came to make a phone call to a senator because we're arranging a meeting for the two Soviet cosmonauts to meet with Senator Harkin this afternoon. Yesterday they met with Congressman Torricelli, and that was wonderful. He agreed to going on the Mir space station.
Really?
Officially, actually,
really?
If invited, so that's a possibility. And he agreed to invite Gretschko, or to have Gretschko send a replacement during hearings that he hopes to call for on the National Commission for Mars, to study Mars, a joint Mars mission.
Well, we have found our Soviet counterparts for Global Family in the Soviet Union. That's the most exciting piece.
What's Global Family, first of all?
Okay, Global Family is an international network of spiritually like-minded individuals, people who, in their own sense of who they are, beginning to go beyond their own personal boundaries and see themselves as part of a global family. See that we have to look at the world as one whole. And so Global Family is a nonprofit organization that supports people to have activities and gather in various activities and projects and events and gets linked through a newsletter and this type of thing so that we can really create it as if we are a global family.
And you found a counterpart in the Soviet Union.
We have found two counterparts. It's fantastic. Now we've watched them together as a team.
I'd just like to see if what kind of a project we have in broadcast media. Just any project.
Well, this is one right here that I'm working on.
Okay, show. Just describe that to me.
Well, it's called the Center for Documentary Cooperation, and they're working on the exchange and production of Soviet-American programming and having a central place for planning co-productions.
Fantastic. And who are the project directors on that?
Let's see. The American contact is Sally Miletz, and Soviet contact person is Alexei Simonov.
Huh, very good. How long have you been doing this?
Well, I did some of this data entry before the summit started, and then I've been doing it all day yesterday and today.
Yeah. How old are you?
I'm 15, going on 16.
Well, this is a mapping center, Dave, and we're taking all of the project reports that have come in as surveys before the conference, and taking all the task force reports and information and connection forms that are being reported on by the task forces, and entering them into databases, sorting them out, representing them graphically, projecting them up on the wall so that analysts and task force leaders can come in and begin to see the cross impacts between task forces. And so they get a picture of the conference as a whole, and some of the connections that they might not see being isolated in their individual task forces.
I see.
I have a Kellogg Fellowship to explore citizen diplomacy, the private sector aspect of Soviet-American relations, and I have been involved in setting up a database that is a research function here on citizen-initiated projects, joint projects with the Soviet Union, and it turned out to be a little more extensive than I anticipated because of the incredible volume of projects that are coming in, this kind of outpouring of private sector initiatives.
The thing is that both our countries and both our peoples are visionary people and with a sense of mission, because we are great nations with great potentials and so on. But come to think of it, I think in later years, we were had too much of a missionary zeal in selling our ways of life, you know, or our models of society somewhere else. And in the process of the selling, we neglected our own societies, you see.
When they say we are the same, and the USSR and America, I beg to differ. We are different, and this difference is beautiful. This difference makes us attract and need one another. Let me inform you of a social invention, a very big one, that happened 3 weeks ago. An international fund for the survival and development of mankind was set up. Why is it a social invention? Because it was the first time when the Soviet Union was taking part in an international foundation. It never happened before.
We propose that global peace be the number one agenda, on the political platform of our leaders in both the Soviet Union and the United States.
And we proposed to those who were the chiefs of that prayer breakfast, the meeting, the conference between 50 American soldiers, privates, I mean, not officers, young soldiers of 20 or 22 or 23 years old, and 50 Soviet soldiers. Let them sit down around round table. Let them see each other, not through the hole of the rifle, but just face to face. Let them speak about their girlfriends. Let's speak them about disarmament. Let's speak about security. Let's speak about their mothers. Let them understand that they were not born to kill each other, but they were born to make our planet better and our relations better.
I trust that you will understand that patience is needed for peace. Patience is needed for understanding. The great Apostle Paul said, "We're all members of one body, and when part of that body becomes sick, the whole body is weakened." Let us recognize that we are part of one body and stand together and patiently work together for peace.
I think these citizen action movements, this kind of activity, is the most important thing going on the planet without fail. It's a sobering fact to recognize that what we are dealing with is not just holding hands across the ocean, however important that may be, not just learning that after all, the Soviets or the Americans, as the case may be, are actually human beings and that we really can learn to get along. But what we have to learn to get along at is this far, far vaster task of together with all the rest of the population of the Earth, making the kind of mind change that will allow us to have a viable planetary future for all time to come.
When we communicate with the American people, we indeed see their open way. They're very friendly. They want to know us. And I would like to wish that we should not cultivate the image of enemy of each other. Little knowledge of each other brings us to a sort of suspicion of each other. But if we feel that we are together to create one global family, we must have trust and goodwill, confidence in each other.
Like the war room, they map all the forces of destruction and plan how to destroy them. In this peace command center, in this situation room of the peoples of Earth, what we do is we scan the whole world for what's working. We map the process that people are now doing in their projects. We bring ourselves together and we communicate it live.
To propose to leaders of the NATO and Warsaw Treaty countries to appoint a joint committee of their respective military chief of staffs to devise a mutual security system devoid of nuclear weapons that will guarantee mutual security of their members' nations.
The purpose of which is to develop specific proposals that encourage the U.S. and Soviet governments to work together to eliminate terrorism.
First, there will be a prototype project where 12 young Soviet citizens, 12 young Americans, and 12 young Costa Ricans, sponsored by the Holy Earth Network, Earth Stewards Network, and the Volunteers for Peace, will go with Komsomolskaya Pravda and Sputnik to Costa Rica for a work camp to do a reforestation project. Secondly, we will be with the group Plowshares and the Soviet Peace Fund. We are going to be sending a team of volunteers, American and Soviet, for 1 to 2 years to work on a life-serving project in the Third World.
Our first proposal would be the first joint U.S.-USSR-UN initiative, which would be the proclamation of an international year for global education. Also the activation of 30 UN days, the establishment of a global association for peace for children of the world, a joint Soviet-American task force and advisory board for Peaceland, which is a creative park for children in Moscow, a clearinghouse for information, and open telecommunication lines between our two countries to facilitate all of the task force projects.
We agreed to meet in 3 months in Moscow to start a joint Soviet-American venture of farmers' exchanges.
A petition to the heads of the Departments of Education in both the United States and the Soviet Union to make courses on healthy parenting and human relationships a standard educational program in our schools. Number two is the establishment of a Soviet-American Council on the Healing Arts.
We have
agreed on children's tourism to the various space centers and space museums in the Soviet Union and the United States, exchange of lecturers in space research, exchange of scientists, and even exchange of astronauts and cosmonauts, a real exchange, a Soviet cosmonaut going into space in an American spaceship, an American astronaut joining a Soviet space mission.
We have committed ourselves to planning for a joint manned mission to Mars around the year 2000. We are committing to studying ways of reconverting the massive space weapons industry and the nuclear arms industry into peaceful uses of space and other technologies.
A project called Faces of the Enemy, an animation film. An agreement has already been signed and work has already begun. We are thankful to our American friends for having suggested making a film about Nicholas Rurik, which we haven't succeeded in making for years, although we have wanted to. We're going to start working on that project shortly.
The main thing that I think has happened here with over 500 Americans and Soviets is that we've overcome the tyranny of bureaucracy. We have met as individuals, not even as organizations. And when people meet person to person to create together, there doesn't seem to be any of the obstacles that ordinarily stop us in bureaucracies.
And that's why the people, ordinary people are ahead of politicians. And that Gorbachev said several times during his speeches, and I think we should agree, and we should ask politicians to follow ordinary people.
Exactly.
We cannot disarm as nations until we learn to trust one another as individuals. And it is to this effort that I feel the citizen diplomats, and I know the Center for Soviet American Dialogue, is dedicated. We cannot trust each other as individuals until we become acquainted with one another, until we become familiar with one another, until we become friends with one another.
I'm an old United Nations official, and I can tell you that some of the projects which have been decided here, like, for example, that a committee shall be established between US top military experts and USSR top military experts to devise a true world security system. A project like this would have taken diplomats at least 5 years to work out. And here it came spontaneously as being the thing which the world needs. And we have about 100 projects of this sort, which will now be studied by the diplomats and the governments on both sides, and they're going to thank God that we did it, because they would have been unable to do it because none of them would have dared to take the initiative.
And my hope and the outcome of the task force that I was in is that I can join with Soviet friends and people from the Third World, and we can start designing that new economy of human resourcefulness so that there will be a new game in the world, the game of mutually assured development, where we can build a win-win world together.
We've been trying to publish a book for 6 years with the Soviet Union, and somewhere between a walk in the hall and a fire drill, we cut the deal. That tells me about the power of this kind of meeting and about all the work that's been done to lead up to this point. This is really a turning point in history. It's a turning point in the evolution of consciousness of humankind. And we're the ones that are making the choice. Every one of you in America, in the Soviet Union, we're the ones that are going to turn the tide. And a choice doesn't go to anybody else. It's you and it's me and it's us together.
Let's fight our battles of socialism and capitalism from an ideological standpoint, not a military standpoint. Let's sell our systems on the strength of what they can perform and on the ideas with salesmanship and marketing, but not with force and with weapons and under the table stuff. Because we can do that. It's very simple. I have, with a Better World Society and a Turner Broadcasting, we have eliminated the word foreign as it applies to people on this planet. Foreign is like ET, that's terrestrial. We're all brothers on this planet. Let's start acting like it.
It's in every one of us to be
both your eyes, we can all know everything without ever knowing why. 'Cause it's in every one of us.
This is an open letter to Secretary General Mikhail Gorbachev, President Ronald Reagan, and the next President of the United States. The letter is entitled The Alexandria Appeal. This letter represents the consensus of the Soviet American Citizen Summit convened in Alexandria, Virginia, February 1 to 5, 1988. About 100 Soviet citizens and 400 Americans have been creating new thinking in the nuclear age and designing social inventions for the third millennium. The title of the summit. Literally hundreds of programs, projects, and concepts have been adopted which will improve understanding between our two countries, move relations towards normalcy, aid our economies, reduce fear and mistrust, increase our security, even provide a roadmap for Soviet-American cooperation for many years to come. We see cooperation as the central imperative to emerge from this conference, inasmuch as we must cooperate with each other to end the arms race, which is the only way to regain healthy economies which can meet the needs of all of our people. We must cooperate with each other to eliminate nuclear weapons from the earth, thus removing the possibility of nuclear annihilation. We must cooperate with each other to avoid the looming environmental crunch. For it is only by reversing these, which we humans have brought upon ourselves, that we will survive. There is a very long way to go before security can be realized for all our citizens. We want to convey to you our hopes and aspirations, and yes, our demands for our security. For if the people of our countries are not secure, our leaders will have failed us.
The anti-ballistic missiles treaty must be adhered to strictly and permanently. No weapon should be designed, tested, or deployed for use in or from space. Nuclear weapons must be eliminated entirely at the earliest possible time. In conjunction with this, conventional forces should be reduced drastically and oriented towards self-defense. Our countries should take the lead in eliminating the sale of and otherwise providing arms to developing nations. We urge that the United States and the Soviet Union enter into massive joint project is in cooperation with other nations to realize our peaceful design, destiny in space, and for the US and the Soviet Union to send manned space ships to Mars, to repair our damage to the environment and assist developing countries in solving their problems before they become our own problems and other projects not yet imagined. We ask your assistance to us, citizens diplomats, in our quest to move toward civility and normalcy. We wish you all speed in carrying out our mandate. Thank you.
We talked about what it might have felt like in the early, early times on this earth before there was any life, and the molecules were bumping against each other, and at some point they discovered the pattern of life and they could see and there was consciousness on this earth. As human beings now are bumping together, more and more joinings have taken place, and yet there are still many who have not connected. Today is about those who have joined to actually bond in their heart, because the magnetic glue that holds the projects together is the love in the hearts of the people. And as magnetism works on the physical level to attract particle to particle, love acts on the human level to attract person to person to create. So those of you who have found your projects, be sure today to take time to know each other personally, to take time to share with each other from the heart, because it will be that bonding that will allow you to have the energy and the perseverance to carry through the project. And those of you who are out there listening, please listen very carefully, because this may be the chance of your lifetime to find what you need. And in some sense, every project is an act of creation.